And I put a thing on the back with the chart of names of God, things like that that will help you in your prayers. Be in prayer for one another for our upcoming revival. Also, you need ladies, if you are planning on going to the District Ladies Day on the 25th, you need to have signed up by March 15th. And scattered throughout the pews today were some mission magazines. Those are for you to take, not to read in church, but to take with you. And please do that. We have its own mission rally coming up a week from Tuesday, 21st, I think it is. Here, I got the paper right on to get it. It's 21st. So, 2 weeks. It will be at Sherman, Church of the Nazarene, and there will be missionaries there that have been serving in Germany and Jerusalem. So that will be interesting to be a part of that. Also, considering missions, I've told you this before, but our church is not just this place. We are Nazarenes. We're a global denomination, and we have responsibilities to our global church, and that issues forth in missions giving. We had a good Thanksgiving offering, and we take an Easter offering, and so that will be on Easter. And our goal for that is going to be $2,200. I didn't know if we could make $2,000, but we did. So I just upped it 10%. I mentioned before, and I'll mention this again, going forward, if you don't like the one big push kind of offering, you can do what a couple of us do, and you can give a faith promise where you decide how much you're going to give for the year, and you break it up into monthly installments. We don't come ask you for it, you just contribute that. God does not need our money, but sometimes our brothers and sisters do, and that's how God ordains it to happen. So we'll give to one another. Our attendance goal for Easter, we want to have a good crowd that morning, is 75. Again, we have not had 75 yet, but we had 67 2 weeks ago. So it is within reach, but it will also cause us to have to invite. So in doing that, we will have our Easter breakfast again like we did last year, and I'll be healthy by then. So I'll be cooking your egg to order that morning, along with all the other nice things that will be there. One last announcement, Rachel Jones is having a birthday coming up, and they have on our church Facebook page information about that, and they're going to have an event over at Fellowship Hall. You're invited, but they need you to sign up on there if you're going to do that, because there's going to be some food involved. So take a look. Yes, and for those of you that use an old-fashioned alarm clock and not your phone, time changes next week. Don't forget. If you use your phone for your alarm clock, it'll remember for you. But if you don't, then it's on you. So spring forward. You're going to lose an hour sleep. One last thing. In the bulletin, it says we have a church board meeting on Thursday, but we don't. Okay. So let's take our hymnals and turn to page 8. And when you're on page 8, let's stand together. I believe in God, Father Almighty,
Maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into Hades, the third day, and rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven. The Holy Church, universal, the communion of saints, the forgiveness. resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen. Let's remain standing as we sing together.
Thank you.
Rachel, this is why we do that when we say it. Let's have our ushers come at this time. Father, we thank you for this day. Thank you for the chance to be together in good times and bad. We thank you for the truth of that song. Your name is blessed, no matter whether we're facing plenty or want. I pray that you would be with each of us, Lord, as we participate in worship now and in giving back to you all that you have given to us. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Today is Acts 18:23 through 19:7 on page 1725 in the Pew Bible. After spending some time in Antioch, Paul set out there and traveled from place to place throughout the region of Galatia and Phrygia, strengthening all the disciples. Meanwhile, a Jew named Apollos, a native of Alexandria, came to Ephesus. He was a learned man with a thorough knowledge of the scriptures. He had been instructed in the way of the Lord, and he spoke with great fervor and taught about Jesus accurately, though he knew only the baptism of John. He began to speak boldly in the synagogue. When Priscilla and Aquila heard him, they invited him to their home and explained to him the way of God more adequately. When Apollos wanted to go to Achaia, the brothers encouraged him and wrote to the disciples to welcome him. On arriving, he was a great help to those who by grace had believed, for he vigorously refuted the Jews in public debate, proving from the scriptures that Jesus was the Christ. While Apollos was at Corinth, Paul took the road through the interior and arrived at Ephesus. There he found some disciples and asked them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" They answered, "No, we have not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit." So Paul asked, "Then what baptism did you receive?" "John's baptism," they replied. Paul said, "John's baptism was a baptism of repentance. He told the people to believe in the one coming after him, that is, in Jesus. On hearing this, they were baptized into the name of the Lord Jesus. When Paul placed his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they spoke in tongues and prophesied. There were about 12 men in all."
Let's stand if we sing.
Yeah.
Oh. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for all that you do for us, Lord. You're so good to us. We don't take enough time to thank you for the way you work in our lives, for the things that you bring to our lives and the things that you keep from us. We know that you are a good God, and we know that you care for us beyond any explanation. We come to you, Lord, as people who have, at our best, not done that great. And you come in perfection. And yet you love us, and we thank you for that, Lord. We thank you that what you expect from us is not something that we don't have. You don't expect from us a mountain that we can't climb, an amount that we can't give. You just expect us to come and say yes, to give what we have, to come to you with the fullness of what we have and say yes and surrender, not holding anything back. We don't have anything really that great anyway, Lord, and sometimes we hold back. And I pray that you would speak to us in that, to that, Lord, that you would help us to understand that you want us to learn what it is to fully commit ourselves to you. Lord, we have some this morning that are not feeling well. I pray that you would be with them. I pray, Lord, that you'd be with Anita this morning, who's not had a good night at all. Touch her, Lord, help her. Continue to touch Mark. Glad to see him getting some things back to normal. I pray that you'd be with Bobby and help him as he's working on this knee replacement and learning to get back to a state of normalcy there. We thank you for the way you've been working in that situation. Lord, I pray that you be with Rebecca this morning. And whatever situation is going on there, you know, Lord, you know how to deal with it. You know how to help with it. And I pray that you would be with those that would like to be here but cannot. And Lord, especially speak to those that we love, that we care about, that don't want to be here. They've chosen not to be. I pray that you would speak to their hearts, Lord, and help them to see that you do love them, but we don't want to have to meet you in a state of us not loving you. I pray that you would help our church as we look to the next few weeks and months toward Easter and toward revival, that you would draw us closer to you, that you would make us more like you than we've ever been before. Speak to us through your word this morning, Lord, and help us to hear what you have to say to us. In Jesus' name, amen. If you're looking at a pew Bible today, we are on 1725. And we're in Acts chapter 18. There was a time before the internet existed. I know that most of us are old enough to understand that, but for a growing number of people, that's a concept that they might accept, but just it's unthinkable that you could do without, or even to consider a time before you could, you know, hold the internet in your hand as we can. I know my own kids, for example, do not want to be told how to get somewhere. If they're going somewhere, they do not want me to tell them how to get there. They don't know. They don't need to know. Their phone knows. This is their theory. And I understand that. I get that. Most of the time it works out. I remember, though, back in the days before that, when, like, if you wanted to go somewhere, you just kind of had to get out paper map and figure things out. When my kids were little, we took a big long 3-week trip out west to Yellowstone and all sorts of places in between. And we didn't have a phone. We just had a piece of paper and kind of some planes. And we made it. Somehow we managed. In between that time and where we are now came like the next leap of technology before we got to where we are, and that was like the GPS navigation. That was a great advantage. It seemed really futuristic. I wanted one. I wanted that little thing to be there with a little map on it and have that little digital map right there on your dashboard telling you which way to go. It was really, really ironic. Most people knew of someone at work that had like a really annoying voice, and then we paid money to put this thing in our car and hear an annoying voice telling us when we made a mistake or when we, you know, which way to go. As great as that tool was, though, there was a problem with it. It was easy to rely on it and then to be let down in a pinch. I know there are many stories, many experiences of driving along using that little thing, only to find out that there wasn't a road where that little thing said there should be, or that there was a new road that that little thing didn't know about. Too late while you were out on that trip, wandering around, you discovered that your device had an update required. In today's passage, we're going to see two examples where updates were required, what the evidence for needing them was, and how they received the required updates that changed those that received them. Again, we're in 18, starting with verse 23. After he'd spent some time there, he departed and went over the region of Galatia and Phrygia in order strengthening all the disciples. A certain Jew named Apollos, born at Alexandria, an eloquent man, mighty in scriptures, came to Ephesus. This man had been instructed in the way of the Lord, and being fervent in spirit, he spoke and taught accurately the things of the Lord, though he knew only the baptism of John. So he began to speak boldly in the synagogue. When Aquila and Priscilla heard him, they took him aside and explained to him the way of God more accurately. So Paul has ended his second missionary journey, and with no real information on what was going on back home, Luke just moves on, Luke being the author of the book. Scholars think that Paul was home for about a year, but now he's back on the road. This guy Paul, he just never quits. He's always working for the Lord. Without a lot of fanfare, verse 23 sort of marks the beginning of his third missionary journey. He's going to go back to some of the churches that he'd already started, and he's encouraging and strengthening the believers there. But then we kind of have an interlude. For many chapters now, without a break, Luke's given us the accounts of Paul's work in the world. But now all of a sudden, it's sort of a meanwhile kind of deal. Like an old Western, only here it's meanwhile, back in Ephesus. We're introduced to a new character, Apollos, a Jew from Alexandria. Who's this guy? I mean, is he an apostle? Well, no, we have the names of them. Was he one of Jesus' other followers? No, he's just some guy, a certain Jew who loved God. What do we know about him? Well, we're told that he's eloquent and mighty in the scriptures. That's awesome, isn't it? I kind of want a t-shirt that says mighty in the scriptures. But I think if I got one, the Lord would probably speak to me about pride, and I wouldn't be able to wear it too many places. Also, it's the kind of thing like, you know, since I mentioned Westerns, it's the kind of thing like if you go around saying you're the fastest guy in the West, somebody wants you to prove it. So if you wear that shirt, then somebody's going to try to make you prove it all the time. Notice that this guy Apollos was eloquent and knew the scriptures. Eloquence was a gift that he had. It was like a knack. It wasn't the natural result of knowing the scriptures. You could know the scriptures very well indeed and not be eloquent. Or, on the other hand, you might be very eloquent and just be a scriptural dunce. The thing is, he was mighty insofar, mighty in the scriptures, but only insofar as the Old Testament went. He only knew the gospel story up to the baptism of John. He had a real need. He required an update. But he wasn't shy. In fact, we're told that he was fervent. That word fervent in the Greek could also be translated boiling. Not like in an angry sort of way. Just, you might say he was just like on fire. He did require an update, that's for sure. We're going to see that. But what he did know was correct, and he wasn't shy about sharing it. He wanted to share it. In the synagogue, he was ready to take his turn. Now, the synagogue was organized in a way that anyone, any man that was there, could bring a lesson, read the scripture, give a word. That's why Paul was able to keep doing it. You'd think, like, why do they keep inviting Paul there if he's just... No, they never invited him there. That's not the way it worked. You're there. You can take your turn, and he would do that. Jesus did that. We saw that in the Gospels. It's not like our churches where there's a pastor and that, you know, the pastor basically does the majority of the speaking. Well, Apollos was there. He was boiling over. And who else was there? Priscilla and Aquila. We've seen them before. I think they were impressed by Apollos and saw that he had a lot of potential. But they could also tell that he required an update. How gracious they were, not only to help him with that, but to take him aside to help him with that. In other words, they didn't call him out in front of everybody and say, dude, what in the world? Why? You need to get with the plan. No, they took him aside and in kindness and gentleness and helpfulness showed him what he needed to hear. In the next passage, verse 27, we read, and when he desired, says Apollos, to cross to Achaia, the brethren wrote, exhorting the disciples to receive him. And when he arrived, he greatly helped those who had believed through grace, for he vigorously refuted the Jews publicly, showing from the scriptures that Jesus is the Christ. Apollos, maybe now Apollos 2.0, you might say. He'd gotten his updates. He was ready to go. I think we should not miss from the previous passage that Apollos was eloquent. He was mighty in the scriptures. He was fervent. But there was something else that he was that was really important. He was teachable. He didn't just stand on those things thinking, well, I got this. He was teachable. How many people have so much potential but never achieve it because they fail at that point? Now, I can tell you stories of that, and you might say, yeah, but those are kids. Yeah, those kids grow up and be adults basically the same way, often. A lot of people aren't teachable. They know what they know. They don't want to know more. Or they might think to themselves, I might be willing to know more, but not from you. Well, okay. I mean, maybe, again, we might excuse that. But if I really want to know the way of the Lord, since that's what we're talking about, should I stand on principle and, like, I'll only allow this person, or that person to tell me? Could it be God would use someone to teach me that I don't particularly like? I mean, you may think, oh, well, no, I don't think that would work that way. Well, then your life's different than mine. God uses people I don't like to teach me things all the time. You have to be teachable. You have to be open to God and say, well, you know, like, the deal is I just want to learn more. I want to be more like you. And then he brings all these things into our life. Did God use things that Job liked to teach him the way of the Lord? No, not at all. Not at all. Apollos wanted to go to Achaia. And you may recall, you may not, that Achaia is a province in what we now know as Greece. And it contained Corinth, big city. Hadn't Paul just come from there? Yes. And if we read Paul's letter to the Corinthians, he says that he, Paul, planted and Apollos watered. The Apollos, with his update, he wants to minister, and now he's equipped and he's ready. It's obvious to the ones there that know him that he's ready, And they send him on after, they send him on his way to the mission field, so to speak. And after he gets after it. He goes in there, he starts debating with the Jews, this time showing from the scriptures that Jesus is the Christ. He'd gotten the update. Now he knows. He's ready. No sooner does he leave Ephesus than Paul shows up. Excuse me. Let's look at the next passage. This is going to be chapter 19, verse 1. It happened while Apollos was at Corinth that Paul, having passed through the upper regions, came to Ephesus. Inviting some disciples, he said to them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" They said to him, "We've not so much heard whether there is a Holy Spirit." And he said to them, "Into what then were you baptized?" So they said, "Into John's baptism." And Paul said, "John indeed baptized with the baptism of repentance, saying to the people that they should believe on him who would come after him, that is, on Christ Jesus." When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul had laid hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they spoke with tongues and prophesied. Now the men were about 12 in all. You may recall that before Paul ended up in Philippi, he had wanted to go to Ephesus, but he wasn't permitted by the Spirit. Now he's free to go there, and immediately he encounters a group of disciples. The word disciples means learners, but generally Luke uses it in the same way that we would use the word Christians or believers. In any case, Paul noticed something about them pretty much immediately. He must have noticed to have asked them what he asked them. Now, to their credit, they didn't take offense. He asked if they received the Holy Spirit when they believed. Their answer, as it's translated here, I think is a little misleading. It pretty much straight up sounds like what they're saying is, they didn't know there was such a thing as a Holy Spirit. And you might look at your translation and say, no, that is what it says, Pastor. Yeah, I get that those are the words. But they just about could not have held to that view. The rest of their answer makes that very unlikely. Because they said they were baptized into John's baptism. Well, John talked about the Holy Spirit. So, I think they just didn't know the Holy Spirit had come. Not that there wasn't such a being. You know, that's why it's really important and a good thing to be working your way through the Bible and not just read the parts you like. Because the Bible translates the Bible. The Bible explains the Bible. And the more you know about the whole thing, it's never going to contradict itself. So if it gets to a part where you like think, well, what is this? This sounds like, but then over here it says this. Well, then you know there's a point there you need to maybe do some research. But there's no contradiction in the Bible in that way. So we think that's not what's going on. We'll set that aside for a moment. Excuse me. So clearly, John the Baptist, he's not around anymore at this time. If he were, though, do you think he'd want these people going around saying they were baptized into his baptism? No, John, he made no claims other than that he was a pointer. He was a voice crying in the wilderness. He was making the way for the one that was greater. He was constantly saying, I need to be less, and he needs to be more. Now, he wouldn't have wanted them to say, you know, I'm John's, you might be Jesus' disciple, but I'm John's disciple. He wouldn't have been too keen on that, I don't think. Paul makes this case to him. He mentions that, yeah, John did preach repentance, and that's great, but it's not enough, which is interesting. Repentance is followed by believing on Jesus Christ. When they heard that, they were convinced. They were baptized, this time in the name of Jesus. Did it make a difference? Well, Paul laid his hands on them, and they had their own little Pentecost right there, complete with prophesying and speaking in other languages. When the original day of Pentecost came, it was Jews from all over the world in that one place. Then you may recall we said that there was sort of a little Pentecost at Cornelius's house, and that one invited local Gentiles into the church. Now, with this Ephesian Pentecost, the rest of the world is invited in. It's interesting that they started with 12. It doesn't say more about it. I just find that interesting. Also, Paul laying his hands on them prior to the outpouring of the Spirit sort of establishes again his credentials as an apostle. And it also, it connects them to the churches that have already been established and the church universal, what we mentioned when we recited the Apostles' Creed. They got the update they required for sure. It's interesting that when we look at Apollos and these 12, they both required updates. But they didn't need the same thing. See, Apollos was teaching in the Spirit already. He needed Priscilla and Aquila to come alongside of him and to help complete his understanding. There was no pretense about Apollos, but he needed to move into the realm of the New Testament. When we think about the 12 here in Ephesus, well, they had a different need. Paul asked them if they'd received the Holy Spirit when they believed, because he saw no real evidence of the Spirit in their lives. He was not, by asking this question, indicating that a person could somehow be accepted into God's family without receiving the Holy Spirit. That's not a thing. He also was not asking to find out if they just had knowledge of the Holy Spirit already active in their lives. To think that a person could have received the Holy Spirit without knowing it is also not a thing. See, God's not going to invade someone's life, barging in where he's not been invited. If he's there, it's because he's been invited. And if he's been invited, he's there. That's how that works. What Paul is really saying when he asks them this question is that he doesn't see evidence of the witness of the Spirit. Now that moves suddenly into the realm of the offensive to an awful lot of people. That kind of question and the thought process behind it is a definite how dare you moment for a lot of people. But could I be honest with you just a minute? The how dare you response in any of its variations really all boil down to the same answer to Paul's question when he said, have you received the Holy Spirit? Whatever that is, the answer is no. The beautiful thing about these 12 is they didn't huff and puff and stomp off saying, well, I'm saved. Who's he think he is? No, they didn't do that. See, I mean, it's almost like a person that would say, well, I took German class in high school. I took German class in high school, by the way. But if somebody came right now, and I passed it too, by the way. In fact, I think I got a B. If I'd have worked harder, I'd probably gotten an A. But I didn't care. That's another story. But I did get a B. You'd think that would be sufficient. But if somebody forced it on me now and said, okay, well, we need somebody that can speak German. You took the class. All right, here it is. Yeah, I can speak German. I can't speak German. They'd start and I would be lost. Well, I took German class. I passed the test. Yeah, but what is it now in your life? It's nothing. I mean, when I go to the doctor, do I want to see that he's got, like, a medical degree on the wall? I do. But if that medical degree is from, say, like 1974, and it appears he's not looked at anything regarding any, you know, material since then, I don't feel so great about that. I passed that test. Yeah, but it's really not active in your life now, is it? That's what Paul's getting at. Well, you passed the test. Okay, whatever. We'll set that aside for right now. It doesn't appear to be active in your life. It doesn't appear, in spite of your protestation, it doesn't appear that whatever you're saying you've got matters for anything. That's an interesting thought. But these guys, they didn't get upset. They heard Paul. Most importantly, or more importantly, they heard God. And they answered honestly, though, like I said, it seems a little misleading to our understanding. We'd not heard there was a Holy Spirit. Must mean they didn't know that the Spirit would evidence himself in the life of the believer. Like I mentioned earlier, John taught that Jesus would baptize with the Spirit. These were self-professed disciples with no evidence of a Spirit-led life. No fruit in their life. Isn't it great we don't have people like that now? Paul had told them that John's baptism was a baptism of repentance, and he didn't knock that. But he told them it wasn't enough. It required an update. You see, repentance is essential. But it's not enough on its own. I wonder why that would be. Well, I think about it this way. When you see the word repent in the scriptures, you notice it's sort of a command or a directive. It's not a passive thing. No one repents for someone else. Jesus certainly can't repent for you. That's what you have to do. My dear departed mother couldn't repent for me. I can't repent for my child. If I could, I guess I'd give it a shot. But I can't. No, each one has to do it on their own. Repent is one of those words in the English language that's possible to exist all by itself as a complete sentence. Repent, usually with an exclamation point. When it's in that one word sentence form, that's possible because the subject is what the grammar teacher would tell you is you understood. The subject is you. You're the subject. You repent. If you have only a religion based upon repentance, you might think that sounds good. You might think that sounds adequate. What's wrong with that? But what that really is a relation, a religion that's based solely upon you and what you do and what you did. I mentioned to you a couple weeks ago, there's no plan B. There's no way to heaven that doesn't involve Christ's work. That doesn't exist. You repent and you confess your faith in Jesus as Lord. That's the winning combination. He won't save you without your cooperation, and you can't be saved without his. I think we find ourselves in need of an update. If you're into such things, you may know that every year Apple produces a major update to their operating system. They have system designers that work on this full time. And one thing I really love about Apple is that the updates are provided free of charge. I don't have to go buy a new phone to get the update. The latest update they did moved the iPhone to iOS, that's the Internet Operating System, iOS version 16. That was the latest update. If you're on 15 or lower, you need a major upgrade. See, those 12 Ephesians, they required a major update. They needed a whole new operating system. But if you were to look at your phone, don't do it right now, and you see that your phone tells you that you're on, for example, iOS 16.3, and then you notice that the latest update is iOS 16.3.1, well, that's a minor update. That's what would be referred to in the tech world as like a tweak. Sometimes what we need is just a tweak. Jesus just needs us to make a slight attitude adjustment. Or we need to learn to look at something a little more from his perspective. The great news is Jesus provides all the updates. If we're willing, well, he's able. Are you in need of a major update? It's like you're on the wrong operating system. You may have repented once in your life. I was going this way, and then I went this way. But really, there's no fruit in my life. There's no evidence that God lives there. Not too many people would accuse me of being a Christian on a regular basis. If so, you need a major update. You need to ask God to rewrite the software of your heart. You need to ask Him to come in, take that repentance, but also then take what He can do. It's not on you. I mean, you got to cooperate, but you can't do more than that. You need to accept Jesus as Lord. The Jesus as Lord part is included in the tweets that we might need. I might have been living for the Lord for a long time now, and then I find out there's an area of my life, even a small one, where I realize there's something that just starts upsetting me. I get upset by this thing that happens. And over, I find myself being upset. Well, if I examine that, I'm probably going to find out there's something there that I've allowed to get in a way that is not pleasing to Jesus. And if I'm going to call Him Lord, that means that He gets to say, this needs rearranged. You need to change this. And I change that. Because He gives me the tweak I need. He shows me. As I'm reading His word, He shows me what I need to do different. I like that one quote on the prayer video you're watching earlier that said, in prayer, I don't inform God. He transforms me. Yeah. See, if I'm just the way I'm supposed to be, there's no transformation necessary. There's no update necessary. But do you think you're like the latest model that God could possibly want? Is there maybe something there that God could, if He really had free reign, He might adjust a little bit?
Yeah.
I would call on you to allow God, both in this moment and also this week, to say, you know, Lord, I don't go to the settings of my life very often to look and see what update I'm on. But I want you to look and just see, am I in need of anything? And if I am, I want to give you free rein to make that adjustment. Let's pray. Father, thank You for knowing all about us. You know all about us. You know everything there is to know about every person here. And You still love them more deeply than they could ever possibly imagine. And You know all about them, and You love them. You love them perfectly, but You don't want us to stay like we are. You love us enough to want us to be better. But You've provided the updates that we need, Lord. They're available to us if we just turn our heart to You and allow You to be Lord of that thing, to be the one in charge. And it could well be, Lord, that that involves our attitude toward another person that must be different if we're going to be like You. Make that update, Lord. It could be our attitude toward our own finances and our lack of generosity with You. If we need that update, Lord, please make that. It could be with our time. That we just so desire to be master of our own time that we never will let You say what we should be doing with our time. Lord, what do we need? I trust You to show me what I need, and I beg You that You would help me to be able to give that to You. And I trust You, Lord, that You know what each one here needs. You know the updates they need. Show them what they need, Lord. If it's a major system upgrade, I pray that they would give their heart to You even now. If it's a minor thing, if it's just a tweak, thank You for being gracious to us and showing us those things that we can change that will make us more like You. We want to be more like you, Lord. We want to be your people. Thank you for hearing us, Lord. And thank you for us hearing from you. We ask your blessings on each one here. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
I don't often say this, but if there's ever a time when you've prayed about an issue, I would ask that you let me know so I can pray with you and be encouraging you in that regard. You are dismissed.